بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه ومن سار على نهجه ومستن بسنته إلى يوم الدين. أما بعد، يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون. ثم أما بعد. My brothers and sisters, on this blessed day of this blessed hour of Yawm al-Jum'ah, we begin by praising Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We send peace and blessings to His Rasul salawatu rabbi wa salamuhu alayhi. And we further ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on this blessed day of this blessed hour of Yawm al-Jum'ah that He accepts from us our righteous deeds and our efforts, and that He forgives us of our shortcomings and our mistakes. Allahumma ameen. Ayyuhal Ahbab, my subject for you today, insha'Allahu ta'ala, in this short Jum'ah reminder, is faith and resilience, especially when the odds are stacked against you. When you feel as though you have certain intentions, you want to pursue something, you want to achieve something great in your life, you have goals, you have intentions in mind, but your circumstance or you as a person or your surrounding just doesn't allow you to do that. So for example, if you aspire to be a doctor or engineer or a particular career, but you don't have the financial means, and as a matter of fact, the schools and the education accessibility is also very limited. If you have intentions to get married at a certain time in your life, so you think in the back of your mind, when I reach this age or that age, I want to be able to get married, I want to find a good spouse, I want to have children, I want to start a family, like you have all of these family planning goals in mind. But when that year comes around, when that time actually comes around, the circumstance just simply doesn't allow you to do so, or the search continues. You haven't found the right person yet. And so many other examples. All of us at a personal level, at a community level, and even at a global level, we all have intentions that we want to achieve certain things in our lives. But for whatever reason, I mean, of course, it's easy to say, and of course, this is true as well, but it's easy for us to just say, well, قَدَّرَ اللَّهُ مَا شَاءَ فَعَلَ. It is what from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, what He wills, and He does whatever He pleases. Yes, that is always the case. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala still tells us that we have to put forth the effort. We have to keep working. We have to keep striving. That to continue to do righteous deeds, that you continue to persevere, you stay confident, you stay faithful, optimistic, and you put in the work. The outcome, that is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's territory. But in terms of the journey, Allah gives us the ability to pace ourselves, to decide what it is that we want to do and how that journey will unfold. So with that being said, a few examples of this. When you feel as though all of the odds are against you, everything seems to be completely impossible. People are even telling you, you're crazy. Why would you even think that you can achieve that? You can do this, you can do that. Why? So there are the naysayers. There's negativity around you. So what do you do when it feels like it's an impossible situation? The first, my brothers and sisters, go back to the messengers, the prophets and the messengers, alayhim salam. Musa alayhi salam, this was a man that had no power, had no education. He had a stutter problem. He had no army, he had no money, no resources, nothing. It was just him and his brother, Harun alayhi salam. Yet still Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told him, اذهب إلى فرعون إنه طغى. Go to Fir'aun and confront him because he's a tyrant. In Surah Al-Qasas, an incident happened, or actually a couple of incidents, and it all started off with Musa alayhi salam and his mother. His mother is being inspired by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, وَأَوْحَيْنَا إِلَىٰ أُمِّ مُوسَىٰ أَنْ أَرْضِعِي فَإِذَا خِفْتِ عَلَيْهِ فَأَلْقِيهِ فِي الْيَمِ وَلَا تَخَافِي وَلَا تَحْزَنِي إِنَّا رَادُّهُ إِلَيْكَ وَجَاعِلُوهُ مِنَ الْمُرْسَلِينَ. So the mother is being inspired by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to take your son and to put him into the Nile, put him into the river. Now just imagine, if you're a parent, putting your child anywhere and leaving them there is horrific and terrifying. So it seems like, what is she doing? It sounds like a crazy scenario. And Allah says, وَلَا تَخَافِي وَلَا تَحْزَنِي. Don't be afraid and don't be sad. But let's just be honest. Especially when you're a parent. When you drop your kids anywhere, you're always going to be afraid. You're always going to be sad to be disconnected from your child that way. And so it's very natural. And what we learn from this incident is that there are two ways to look at this ayah. The first is just as a human being. She's a mother. So of course she's going to feel sad. But what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is referring to is don't allow the sadness and the grief to overwhelm you to the point where you question what Allah is doing and why is this happening. So that's the second fold or the second way to look at this scenario. But the point is, when all odds are against her, it feels like it's an impossible situation. How is she ever going to see her kid again? She has no idea what's about to unfold. The only thing Allah tells her is, إِنَّا رَدُّهُ إِلَيْكَ وَجَعِلُهُ مِنَ الْمُرْسَلِينَ. Don't worry, we're going to return him back to you and we're going to make him amongst the best of messengers. Then things continue to unfold. Musa alayhi salam, when he matures and he becomes an adult, he enters a city. وَدَخَلَ الْمَدِينَةَ عَلَى حِينِ غَفْلَةٍ مِّنْ أَهْلِهَا. He enters a city where he himself is not really familiar with the people who live in that city. And he notices that there's an altercation between two men. هَذَا مِنْ شِيعَتِهِ وَهَذَا مِنْ عَدُوِي. So one of them was an enemy, but the other one was somebody that recognized Musa alayhi salam and thought that they were on the same side. فَاسْتَغَاثَهُ الَّذِي مِنْ شِيعَتِهِ عَلَى الَّذِي مِنْ عَدُوِي. So this man actually asked Musa alayhi salam for help against this man who he called the enemy. And he says, Musa, come and help me. You know, this guy, we're fighting here. There's an altercation happening. I need your help. Everybody knows what happens next. Musa alayhi salam gets involved. He takes the life of this man. فَقَضَى عَلَيْهِ فَوَكَزَهُ مُوسَى فَقَضَى عَلَيْهِ. So Musa finished him off, but then he said something. هَذَا مِنْ عَمَلِ الشَّيْطَانِ. This is actually from the influence, from the actions of shaitan. Now pause for a moment. Musa alayhi salam is not blaming shaitan for what he did. What he's saying is that the influence, like I gave in to the temptation of shaitan. Shaitan tempted me and whispered to me and encouraged me to get involved. And I continued to pursue that to the point where this man now died. And that's what Musa alayhi salam, he learned from that moment. And he says, هَذَا مِنْ عَمَلِ الشَّيْطَانِ. The proof for this is in the word عَمَلٌ. There are two words in the Quran to describe action. You have عَمَلٌ and you have فِعْلٌ. If you say فِعْلٌ, it's generic. Like you just do a random act. But if you say عَمَلٌ, that comes with an intention. You think it through and then you do it. So Musa alayhi salam actually thought this through and he made a decision by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's will. But here's the point. Here's the point. Musa alayhi salam does not know where this is leading to. And so as you continue in Surah Al-Qasas, Musa alayhi salam, وَأَصْبَحَ فِي الْمَدِينَةِ خَائِفًا يَتَرَقَّبْ. When all of this whole scenario was done, then he goes to bed and the next day he wakes up and he's afraid because he doesn't know what the outcome is going to be. He doesn't know if there's people looking for him. He doesn't know if he's wanted. So he's scared, like, what's going to happen to him? Point is, it's one trial after another, after another, after another. Pause with that story. Let's look at another situation. Maryam alayhi salam, an angel, Jibreel alayhi salam, comes to him and gives her the glad tidings that you're going to have a child. The first thing she does is she asks Allah to protect her from whoever this individual is. And she even tells him, how is anybody going to make me pregnant if I've never been with anyone to begin with? And as the story unfolds, again, she's thinking about herself, she's thinking about her reputation, how is she going to go back in front of her family, in front of her community, and they're going to see that she's pregnant. They're going to think that she did something she wasn't supposed to do. Again, the situation looks like it can't get any worse. Maryam alayhi salam was a pious woman even before this incident. She was a woman that lived in a masjid. She prayed tahajjud. She constantly turned to Allah. She prayed and she made dua. This was her entire life. Yet now she wakes up one day and now she's going to have a child. And as it continues, She realizes that she doesn't have a choice in the matter. And the pain and the struggle, she even says, how I wish I could have died before this pain began. So these are the labor pains that she's going to start to experience. She actually says, I wish I wasn't alive to experience this. Now pause, one last story. Our Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, 23 years of pain and struggle. Some of the pain and struggle, impossible for many of us to even imagine and comprehend. I mean, you're talking about his own family, Abu Jahl and Abu Lahab. You're talking about his own uncles trying to torture him, embarrass him, humiliate him, target him, persecute him. They cursed at him. They tried to do everything in their power to humiliate their own family. And the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, even there was a point in Mecca where he almost felt like as if he gave up. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala captured that moment at the end of Surah Al-Hijr, when it felt like everything was against him. وَلَقَدْ نَعْلَمُ أَنَّكَ يَضِيقُ صَدْرُكَ بِمَا يَقُولُونَ Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, I know what you're going through. I have knowledge of it. That your chest, that your heart, that your stomach, that everything on the inside feels like it's tightening up and there you just can't breathe. And this happens to a lot of us, that emotionally when things become overwhelming, you feel like you can't eat, you can't drink, you can't talk to anybody, you can't sleep. And so the Prophet ﷺ is feeling all of that. Yet Allah gives him reassurance. 23 years he's going through this. All he wants to do is spread his message that there is just one creator that should be worshipped. Yet assassination attempts have been made on him. This is not just in Mecca, but then when he gets to Medina, there's one battle after another, and he almost dies in many of them. And he's injured pretty bad, and he's doing this, and he holds on, and he continues for the sake of pleasing his Creator. It was not easy. So where are we going? You've heard three stories. Where are we going with all of this? My brothers and sisters, when you think about something that you're passionate about, you know, whether it be a movement, whether you're trying to make a statement or bring awareness to an issue. Now we're living in a world where George Floyd and that whole entire incident, and even those who were wrongfully killed prior to him, so many years of this level of injustice, so many years of this level of unfairness. This is a community that's been marginalized, that's been targeted, and they've really suffered big time. And people around the world have now began to stand up and make a statement that enough is enough. But then you have many leaders, politicians, you have other groups that are countering this message, that are saying it's not a big deal. Like, who cares? It's okay, so one person died. So what's the big deal? We don't need to vandalize. We don't need to loot. I mean, I understand that when it comes to all of the things that are not connected to the message, yeah, that's not right. I mean, taking advantage of people's businesses and stealing from them when those businesses have nothing to do with the incident is simply wrong. It's kind of taking advantage of that situation. But nevertheless, seems like it's almost an impossible task. For so many years, people have died, and they've died wrongfully and unjustly and unfairly. And movements and protests continue each and every year to try to get the message to stop this kind of brutality, to stop this kind of treatment. And it looks like it's impossible. When is it going to end? There are still leaders and politicians that are perfectly fine, that haven't really stood out and voiced their hate against this kind of behavior, against this kind of treatment. And so for you as an individual, especially if you're part of that minority, you think to yourself, is this ever going to change? And you start thinking about your family, your children, your grandchildren. You start thinking about that whole generation. How are they going to grow up? How are they going to survive through this? If it's this bad now, what's going to happen 10, 15 years later down the line? And so what do you do? First and foremost, brothers and sisters, at least from a Quranic perspective, all the prophets and messengers, alayhim salam, went through hardship that you and I, we could imagine some of it, but many parts of it, we can't fathom what it must have felt like, and the experience, and the stress, and the pain. and the mental, the exhaustion and the emotional hardship that's attached to all of that. We don't know how we would have felt at that moment, but these prophets and messengers continued to have one secret ingredient, and that was faith. They held on to faith. How did they do that? When Musa alayhi salam accidentally took the life of this man, the first statement that he makes to Allah is, he says, قَالَ رَبِّ إِنِّي ظَلَمْتُ نَفْسِي فَغْفِرْ لِي فَغَفَرَ لَهُ إِنَّهُ هُوَ الْغَفُورُ الرَّحِيمُ. The first thing he asks Allah is, oh Allah, I've done something wrong. So what does he do? He admits his mistake. But then he asks Allah to forgive him. And Allah forgives him because Allah is the most forgiving and merciful. So the first thing, and this is what Maryam alayhi salam, she does as well. She turns to Allah Azza wa Jalla, قالت إني أعوذ بالرحمن منك. She says, oh Allah, I seek your protection from this man, whatever he's trying to accuse me or say to me that I'm going to have a child. So the thing is, she calls Allah for help. And the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, his entire prophethood was all about dua. Every night he's praying tahajjud. Even when they're in the middle of a battle, when the companions go to bed that night, the Prophet alayhi salatu wa sallam, the leader, he's in the night praying and making dua that Allah gives them aid, that Allah gives them help. So the first thing is, if we want to establish our faith and strength and continue to strive for what is right, not just for ourselves, but for our community and the people around us, and at the and all of us as inhabitants in this world, to make it a better place that we can all live peacefully, not just for ourselves, but for future generations. And the first thing that as believers we have to do is that we must always seek Allah's help. No one has ever been able to overcome any hardship except that they had to ask Allah for help. Yusuf alayhi salam, when he was about to be seduced by the wife of the Aziz in the palace, it's a pretty messed up scenario. I mean, if he gets caught with this, his whole life could have been over, he could have been executed, and so many terrible things could have happened to him. But the point is that when he was confronted by this woman, the first thing he says is, قَالَ مَعَاذَ اللَّهِ. He says, oh Allah, protect me from this situation. He called upon Allah before he could have potentially fallen into a sin. So the scholars teach us that to protect yourself from even any level of sin and mistake that you could be exposed to, you must call upon Allah. Nobody has the ability to overcome a sin without the help of Allah. And so the first thing to maintain that faith and that strength and resilience in times where you think everything is against you and it's an impossible situation, is just remember, the one who has Allah, nothing is impossible. The one who has that connection with their Creator is always able to achieve, bi-idhnillah. Number two, and this is the last and final point, with every prayer and dua must come work, the effort has to be there. Musa alayhi salam, when he was told, go to Fir'aun, he didn't say, oh Allah, are you serious? Like, could you choose somebody else? He stepped up, despite he had no money, no resource, no army, nothing. All he asked is, وَجَعَلْنِي وَزِيرًا مِّنْ أَهْلِ هَارُونَ أَخِي. He just said, oh Allah, can you just allow me to take my brother with me, Harun? Just at least allow him to come with me. And in Surah Al-Qasas, he describes why. وَأَخِي هَارُونَ هُوَ أَفْصَحُ مِنِّي. That my brother Harun, he's a bit more eloquent than me. He can speak a little bit better. So I need him for that kind of support. So he asks Allah for help. Allah gives it to him. And so the point is that he does the work. Then he goes out there and Allah gives him reassurance. إِنَّنِي أَسْمَعُ وَأَرَى. I hear and I be. I hear and I see. So you're okay, Musa. I'm with you all the way. You see, when we approach impossible situations with confidence that Allah is with us, we can turn to Him whenever we want, but we actually do the work. The Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, despite that each and every single day of his prophethood, odds were stacked against him, he never gave up. And this is my message in this short reminder to all of us listening. is as believers, as long as you strive for what is right, what is just, and what is fair, never give up. Have faith in your Creator. Ask Him to help you. Ask Him to give you the strength to get through. Now put aside at a community level, just at a personal level. If you're suffering through depression, anxiety, if you've got your own personal problems, you just came out of a terrible divorce, or you've been trying to get married, but nobody wants to marry you. And you've been looking for a spouse for so many years, but you just there's a stigma out there that nobody wants to marry somebody like you that may have kids. You might have reached a certain age. And none of that stuff is your fault. You just want to be able to move forward. It's dua. Ask Allah to give you what it is that you desire. Righteousness. Ask Allah to allow you to be married and bless you with a righteous spouse. The point is, stay connected with Him. And number two, continue. Don't give up. The prophets and the messengers had every reason to give up in their situation. Ayyub alayhi salam could have given up easily. I mean, this is a man that lost everything in his life, including his health. And he was the only prophet amongst all prophets that we know of that was actually rich, that was blessed with power and money. And all of that was taken away from him. Yet what does he do? He continues, he still continues, وَإِذْ نَادَى. He continues to call out upon Allah and continue to pray to Him. Despite that, how distant he may have felt in his situation, he was bedridden, he still called out to his Creator. All the prophets and messengers did the work at the end of the day. And so we have to continue to work and strive. So not only that we make this world a more peaceful and pleasant place to live, but just for sanity, for us as believers, that we're able to cope with all of the pressures and all of the struggles and hardships that we will confront, that will confront us, we will come in contact with. So when those moments arrive, we're able to understand, okay, this is from Allah's will. It's a test of my strength. I have faith. I've been working on my faith during the easy times so that when these difficult times come, I'm able to get through, insha'Allah ta'ala. Let's just pause here. I'm going to take the short break, the short jalsa. And when I stand up, insha'Allah ta'ala, we'll conclude the short reminder. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala continue to give us the strength, the faith and the resilience, the patience, the knowledge, the will, that we continue to strive to establish what is right and what is just, not just for believers, but for all of mankind, to the best of our ability and capacity. Allahumma ameen. أقول ما تسمعون وأستغفر الله لي ولكم ولسائر المسلمين من كل ذنب فاستغفروا إنه هو الغفور الرحيم. بسم الله الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله عليه أفضل الصلاة ومن والاه. And so to conclude, brothers and sisters, these are difficult times that we're living with. I mean, we talked about George Floyd, we talked about the protests, we talked about all of the chaos happening, but let's not forget, we're still in the midst of a pandemic. It might seem like, how is life ever going to return back to normality? How are we ever going to sit beside each other again? How are we ever going to get into our masajid? And even the simple things, how can I ever like just jump in my car and go to the mall, go to the grocery store and just go peacefully? Now we have to mask up, we've got to social distance, we've got to do all of these different things, and who knows how long it lasts. But the believer, we have faith. We have faith and trust that Allah knows what He's doing. Just like the prophets and messengers, these are the things that we inherited from them. That during the most difficult and impossible situations, they still had faith. They never gave up on their faith and trust with Allah. And that's what got them through that. And secondly, they put the work. They put in the effort. And so we continue to put in the effort. We got to put in the work, continue to strive to find a cure. And if that's not something that you're involved with, then at least continue to follow those rules. Take your precautions, but continue to strive to make this moment work for us. And don't allow a pandemic to stop your entire life. But you still continue with the trust and faith by taking all of the precautions. You trust that you have faith in Allah will get you through this time and any other situation. And the last and final sentence that I leave you with is always remember, as Allah reminds us in the Quran, you will never go through a situation that you cannot handle. Allah will never put that kind of burden on you. You know, if that was the only sentence we had of the entire Quran to give us reassurance and strength, it would be enough. Because it's coming directly from Him subhanahu wa ta'ala, who obviously is our creator, He knows us best. And He's telling you and I will never overburden you with more than what you have the ability or the capacity to handle. I will never do that. So everything in your life that you're going through, seeing and experiencing this very second, guess what? You have what it takes to get through it. You just have to have faith. You have to keep that connection with Him subhanahu wa ta'ala. You gotta continue praying. You have to continue to talk to Him. Not just in times of difficulty, but also in the times of stability and peace. Have to maintain that relationship. Don't be like what Allah referred to in Surah Yunus. فَلَمَّا كَشَفْنَا عَنْهُ الضُّرْ مَرَّ كَأَن لَّمْ يَدْعُنَا إِلَى ضُرٍ مَسَّ. Whenever when we lifted that burden away from them, the hardship was lifted, they were cured. They went back to their old ways. They went back to their old life. As if they were never sick, they never had any hardship to begin with. Don't be of that group, because that would be a spiritual tragedy. And so I pray that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives us the strength that we continue to have faith, patience and strength, and that we put forth the work and the effort, that we don't give up. We don't give up on what we strive for that is just, that is fair. Not just for us, but for all of mankind. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us the strength that we continue to learn His deen. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless us with patience to get through this difficult time. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala heal the world from this pandemic. Allow us to reunite in our communities, with our families and our friends, in our masajid, in our Islamic institutes. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us the patience and strength to get through this difficult time. Allahumma ameen. So this is what I leave you with, brothers and sisters. It's a short reminder, but I hope it's a reminder that can uplift and inspire you to feel good about yourself, to feel good about your situation, but more importantly, to feel as though you have the confidence and the ability and the will to get through whatever struggle it is that you're going through. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make that easy for you and all of us. Allahumma ameen. Now it's time for you to, if you haven't done so already, to pray your 4 rak'ats, Salatul Dhuhr. Jazakumullahu khayran. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.